the whole length of Shore Road from Fort Williams Park to Fawn Cove, we do a test section. And that we do it in a way that is with other work that we're doing, other maintenance. That was the gist of the discussion I was getting.
The way I understood.
Some nods. Counselor Linnell?
Yeah, I have two questions. One is, would the town manager anticipate that we would have to do any other engineering studies in connection with this? And secondly, would this test strip create a narrow spot in the road where it would be more dangerous? Where people, where they'd create a hazardous situation for bicyclists?
We'd take all those factors into account when we chose the test area. We'd try to do it in a place that didn't require engineering, and we'd try to do it in a place that wouldn't appear to fall into that trap of, you know, suddenly blinding out into nothing, so someone goes to around a corner and suddenly there's nothing there. We'd try to take those things into account as we chose the test area.
Thank you, Mr. McGovern.
Counselor Groff?
That doesn't really satisfy my concerns in the sense that if I read the police chief's recommendations correctly, at a minimum, the right-of-way, not only should we have better signage, but we should also, at a right-of-way, have the shoulders with some type of composite material actually brought up to the roadbed to prevent what is a common occurrence on Shore Road of the soft shoulder being well below the paved shoulder and people coming off with their bike or running and not being able to do that. And I don't understand why, as part of this issue of having a portion of Shore Road having a 2-foot strip, why we're also not having a more comprehensive report coming back to the council as to the cost at a minimum of making the immediate improvements that the chief of police suggested.
Would you like to amend it to include that?
I would.
It's fine with me.
So my understanding of the amendment, so I understand what we're to implement, is to bring back a proposal similar to what Councilor Groff said earlier that looks at increased enforcements, that attempts to address the absolute problem areas, and that presents back to the council the current accident statistics with the latest possible information, and anything else we deem appropriate that we think is falling within the spirit of what the council is requesting.
That's what I would like to see, a comprehensive proposal coming back to the council that the citizens of this community can have some confidence in, that the council understands that improvements to the safety of Shore Road are necessary, and what we can rationally do, and not just give false hope that we can do.
I would like to ask the manager if that work can be completed at the municipal staff level or if any outside consultants are going to be necessary.
I don't envision we'll have any consultants. I'll work on it some this week with the appropriate municipal staff. When I go on vacation, they'll be continuing the work, and when I get back from vacation, we'll go over the progress that's been made. And you know, they do a good job. They're perfectly capable of acting while I'm gone and progress along with it.
Thank you. I need to clarify that the next to the last sentence, the scheduling, would be done as part of an overall drainage plan. Was that part of it, Councilor Cogswell?
Well, we are working in the tide edge area on the drainage plan. So that could be a possible area where we could be envisioning this 2-foot experimental strip in addition to the reinforcement of the shoulders as we go immediately. You want me to say Tide's Edge?
No, I just wanted to make sure I understood it well. I thank you. Counselor Graff?
I just have a problem limiting it to Tide's Edge. My understanding is the chief of police would come back, not the chief of police, but the staff of the town would come back, and if there are other areas of Shore Road that are a major problem at this point in time, even after we would implement the chief's recommendations of having the shoulder improvements that he's discussed, that part of the comprehensive program that we would see, the proposal that we would see, is that here are certain areas that we can actually take immediate action on in Shore Road, and that might include a two-foot shoulder in that area where there is a real issue. And I don't want to tie the staff's hands that the only way they can consider that is if there's a drainage issue going on or something else. I'm more concerned about the safety aspect.
So you would move to amend the motion to drop that sentence?
I would. Or you can put a word in, they can attempt to have the, as long as there's some room to move, so that if there's an area of Shore Road that is an immediate safety concern, that it can be considered along with areas that are going to have some other type of drainage maintenance.
So change the shall to may?
May.
Do you see that, Debbie? The scheduling of the project may.
Is that acceptable to the seconder?
Yes.
Thank you, Counselor. Counselor Linnell?
Yeah, I just have a question. Before we get any further into this, I'd like to get a sense from the council. For example, if this project, you know, say the chief and the staff recommend a half mile, both sides, 2 foot, and it costs $35,000. Is this council going to vote to spend that money? I'd just like to get a feel for if people are going to be comfortable spending $35,000 town money for, say, half a mile of 2 foot paved shoulders.
I'm not sure. When would you anticipate the work being done? The question that comes to my mind is, would this be something that this council votes on or a subsequent council?
I think it depends on an item later in the agenda, but you know, as I understand this motion, we've been asked to comprehensively look at Shore Road, and you know, that doesn't necessarily mean we're only looking at paved shoulders. There may be other things we're looking at as well, and you know, what time frame that might take, you know, until we've really had an opportunity to sit down and talk it over, I'm not ready to say, but we will take a comprehensive look at it. We will look at other issues as well. Speed, you know, we'll look at speed. You know, we'll pursue that as well. You know, just because Mr. Chase says no, it doesn't necessarily mean that everyone at MDOT's going to say no. You know, there are a whole host of issues to look at.
Enforcement.
Madam Chair.
I would feel uncomfortable, Councilor Linnell, to try to tie this council down when, in fact, it may be a different council that votes on that financial amount.
Well, I understand that this wouldn't be binding in any way, but if we tonight, we're not doing this in a vacuum. We're about to say goodbye to $320,000 of our tax dollars in contribution, and if we're willing to do that, I want to know. I would like to just sort of get a sense if the alternative. Because we're voting on something we know very little about. I think the four-foot proposal on each side is a devil we know a lot better than the one we're talking about. There's a lot more questions, I think, raised by this other proposal. And I think it's fair, if we're going to turn our back on, you know, this is, at this point, it's pretty much a one-shot deal. We're going to walk away from it. And if we're going to do that, I want to know that if this proposal were 20,000, 30,000, 35,000, say, in total cost, engineering, gravel, signs, whatever, would people, would they intend to support it? Or would we, or would it be killed again? And again, I understand it's not binding, I just want to know how people feel.
Counselor Reed?
I'll tell you. I'm not voting for the motion, and I wouldn't vote for 2-foot-wide shoulders, based on what I know about safety.
Thank you.
Thank you. Counselor Jordan?
No, I don't want to sit here and commit myself of whether I'm going to spend $10 or $100,000 6 months or 8 months from now. I want to see what the project's laid out and where it is.
Counselor Graff?
I also would wait and see, but my inclination is not that it's necessary. Everything doesn't have to be measured in dollars. I think we can make improvements in Shore Road as to the safety, and it doesn't necessarily get tied into dollars. What I do know is that the death of this bike path, in my view, was once we went down the road of 9 conditions and we sat there and we said that the whole key is come back, spend $80,000, and we're going to look at it then. And my judgment was based upon the fact that that is the devil I know, and the devil I know, it wasn't going to happen after we spent $80,000. And this devil I don't know, but I have hope that we're going to raise the consciousness of this town about the danger of Shore Road, and we're going to take rational steps to do what we can to improve the safety.
Councilor Coxell?
Yes, there are several measures that can be taken immediately. The enforcement of the speed limit, advisory signage that can be done immediately that will help enhance the safety of the road with minimal expense. And I think that we need to take that action now, and if it costs $100 or $1,000, I definitely would vote for that to be done immediately.
I'd like to move the question.
Thank you, Councilor.
Can I just say something?
Not after it's been moved.
Thank you.
No. Okay, there is a motion on the floor with a number of amendments. Is there anybody who needs clarification on the motion before it's voted on? All those in favor? All those opposed? Vote is 5-2. That's the first item on the agenda tonight. Item 59 is a vote on the acceptance of state and federal funds for Two Lights Road bike path. Anything else to say? Councilor Coxell?
Yes, we received tonight some information that I believe you had the Chief Public Works Department and the police. I've been shuffling papers here, I've lost it. About the proximity of various structures to the currently paved surface. Unfortunately, we do not know exactly where the right-of-way lies on this road and where in that right-of-way the paved surface is. So it's helpful, but yet it's not helpful because we're dealing more with an unknown. So we have received a petition and several letters from people on this particular road. And I feel this road is a completely different character than Shore Road. The site distance on Two Lights Road is remarkable, except for one particular area where Hannaford Cove intersects. And that alone is a dangerous situation. But I feel, too, that this particular area would be helped by shoulder fortification and slight widening without getting into the full standards of the federal requirements of 4 feet on each side. So therefore, I'm going to make a motion of option A, so small a, to direct the town manager to inform the Maine Department of Transportation, writing that the town will not be moving forward with the proposed Two Lights Bikeway project, and that the state and federal share of the project will not be used for the proposed project by the town of Cape Elizabeth. B, to direct the town manager to work with the Department of Public Works to comprehensively plan a proposal for the installation or fortification of the shoulders wherever practicable along both sides of Two Lights Road from Route 77 to Two Lights State Park. The shoulders shall not cause the relocation of any stone wall in the right-of-way, nor the removal of any tree over 3 inches in diameter at its base. There should be no taking of land, and proper drainage shall be maintained. The scheduling of the project shall be done as part of an overall roadway drainage plan to be presented and then voted upon by the town council. The plan will provide cost estimates sufficient to ensure completion of the work. And I guess I want to amend that other sentence, Debbie, where it says the scheduling of, that if necessary, to move it up in the priority list. If necessary, the scheduling of the project shall be, if necessary, the project shall be moved up in the priority list so that it can be done as part of an overall.
Yeah, I just want to clarify, in these draft motions, the overall roadway drainage plan is the annual five-year plan you get that lists everything we need to do with roads and drains and sidewalks, et cetera. That's what's being referenced there.
Can I ask a question to the town manager?
Yes, Councilor O'Neill.
Thank you. Now, if we do this, Mr. Manager, would we be shifting money away from other roads in town, other projects that might otherwise have been done?
When we do the annual five-year update of roadway drainage, there's shifting that does go on trying to find the money that needs to get done. You know, there's a whole list of things that always need to be done, and we try to find the money. But you know, right now, the town appropriates $200,000, and I think, you know, you're aware that we've got the tide the drainage project. We've got Fowler Road needs some work, Old Ocean House Road coming up into the center of town. We got Pleasant Avenue you received a petition on. Mm-hmm. Old Ocean House Road's awfully bumpy. We have whatever we're going to do on Shore Road.
Okay. Thank you. I guess, you know, my concern is that, you know, we'll be robbing Peter to pay Paul. It's coming from somewhere, and so if this goes forward, if some people wonder why their road doesn't get improved 5 years out, you'll know why. I don't think, you know, we don't get something for nothing.
Thank you.
Councilor McGinty?
Can I get a clarification on the motion?
Certainly.
There was no mention of 2 foot shoulders. Was that by design or just an oversight? She didn't read that. She said for a comprehensive plan for the installation or fortification of shoulders. Was that just an oversight?
That was an oversight, yeah.
I didn't hear the answer to that.
It was an oversight.
Okay, so you want to retain the language about 2 foot shoulders.
Right. Whichever.
Okay.
I don't think there's been a second, though.
We do have a motion on the floor. We do not have a second.
I'll second and move it on.
Thank you, Councilor Jordan. Discussion?
Madam Chairman?
Councilor O'Neill?
Yeah, I just think we're, you know, it's kind of a Band-Aid approach. If there really isn't a cost associated with this, I don't understand why we're not doing it anyway. Why aren't we looking out for safety issues on our roads, putting up signs where appropriate? I'm not sure that anything dramatically different will occur, and I'm not convinced that this isn't going to cost something. If it doesn't cost anything, I'm not sure it's going to accomplish much. You find you have to put resources where you know, very few things are free, and you have to put resources where you want things done.
Thank you. Councilor Graff?
I am going to vote against Councilor Coggeshall's motion. I believe that Shore Road and Two Lights are different. I believe that with the conditions that we would attach to the design grant, that Two Lights will actually be built. I think that's going to work. I think if you talk about the difference with Two Lights, 2 or 4 feet, we are, in effect, not spending the town's monies wisely, because we are better off putting a 4-foot lane there. I would also point out that if we do that road, and I respect the people who live on that road, I've looked at the distances, and I think with some conditions that we can minimize that impact, but for this metropolitan area, we will have a bicycle path that goes from Portland down 77 and to Two Lights State Park, and I think that is a service for the entire metropolitan area. State money's well spent. I think sometimes we have to have a little bit broader view than just our parochial view, and I believe this bike path will happen. The reason I voted against Shore Road was it was, in my view, not going to happen. And for that reason, I will vote against this motion, and I will support, hopefully, a subsequent motion to accept these funds.
Councilor Reed.
I also will vote no on the councilor's motion, and I will make a motion for option B should the first motion fail.
Anybody else? Councilor McGinty.
I'm going to be supporting the motion. Two Lights Road, exception of what, again, Councilor Coggeshall said, with the exception right by Hannaford Cove Road, it's pretty much a straight shot with good sight line distances. I truly don't think that we need to put, a full-blown, 4-foot-wide lane on each side of that road. I just don't think it's necessary, period.
Thank you.
No, I'm all set. I'm going to vote in favor of the motion because I feel 2 foot different widths of a bikeway down there would be adequate.
Thank you. I intend to vote against the motion for the same reasons I was speaking to for Shore Road. Seeing no further discussion, let's do a roll call vote on this, as I'd indicated. Please.
Councilor Coggeshall?
Yes.
Councilor Graff?
No.
Councilor Jordan?
Yes.
Councilor Linnell?
No.
Councilor McGinty?
Yes.
Councilor Reed?
No.
Chairman McLaughlin?
No.
Motion fails 3-4.
Thank you. Councilor Reed?
Madam Chairman, I move we authorize the town manager to notify the Maine Department of Transportation of the town's desire to move forward with the design of the bikeway pedestrian shoulder on Two Lights Road from Route 77 to Two Lights State Park, subject to the following guidelines. First, the shoulder shall not exceed 4 feet in width on either side. I'll add with the exception of 5 feet where curbed, although I believe there are no curbed areas. Second, the shoulders may be narrower at locations to avoid wetland filling. Third, stone walls in the right-of-way may be relocated as a project expense if in the way of the project. Four, design is to be completed by a firm hired by the town of Cape Elizabeth. Five, a local design review committee consisting of 5 citizens with the town manager and director of public works serving as ex officio members shall be appointed by the town council to work with the consultant. Six, a final design shall be approved by the Cape Elizabeth town council. Seven, there shall be no taking of land for this project. And eight, proper drainage patterns and snow storage areas, I guess, shall be maintained.
Councilor Reed, just following up on some of the language we had in the previous item on your number 2, Do you want to say anything about other areas determined to be particularly unique?
I really do. I think that that's appropriate. Thank you. Or other areas determined to be particularly unique, I think is the MDOT language.
Is there a second to the motion?
I'll second the motion.
Thank you, Counselor Graff.
Question, Clerk?
Yes, we have a question from Clerk.
Counselor Reed, on number one, am I correct that the shoulders shall not exceed?
4 feet in width on either side.
Shall, not may?
May.
May. Did I say shall?
Yes.
I'm sorry.
Okay. And the same on number three, stone walls in the right of way may be relocated?
May, not shall.
Thank you.
We have a motion and a second. Mr. Counselor McGinty.
Just another clarification. I believe when she read number five, I thought she said five citizens instead of seven. I may have misheard that, but I thought.
I meant seven.
Okay.
Thank you. Any other clarifications? Council discussion? Council Coxell.
I guess I'm concerned about the stone walls may be relocated because in a way that is a taking a private property if it's someone's wall they built, even though it is in the right of way. And we did offer that courtesy to and the others, so I would like to see that stay as shall instead of may.
Councilor Reed, it's your motion.
I don't understand the distinction. If someone puts something in the public way, it's not private property, is it?
The standard practice is that we maintain the practice of sufferance. Sufferance is that we tolerate it in the right of way, but that we bear no responsibility for it. That's the standing town policy.
So it may or may not have to be relocated depending on what's going on the other side of the road or what's going on in that area. Is that correct? I was going for the least restrictive in my suggestion to change the word to may.
My recollection is that the question's really moot, that there aren't any stone walls that would need to be removed anyway.
That's my understanding.
It's not a pillar.
I'll go to shall. I don't care. There aren't any that are affected, so.
Put it to shall. Does the seconder concur?
Fine.
Thank you. That's why the clerk has an eraser. Further discussion? Seeing none, I'd like to ask the clerk for a roll call vote on this, please.
Councilor Cogsall?
No.
Councilor Graff?
Yes.
Councilor Jordan?
No.
Councilor Linnell?
Yes.
Councilor McGinty?
No.
Councilor Reed?
Yes.
Chairman McLaughlin?
Yes.
Motion carries 4 yeas.
Thank you. We had a request from a counselor for a recess. Council will be in recess for 5 minutes until 10:06. Thank you.
Thank you. I need to stand.
Can you get both?
Stand.
You don't want this job back, Steve?
I think it's appropriate.
So far, they're following the feature record.
Yeah. Oh, just the article.
It's so that it can be rejected. I went to the workshop. You were there. Yeah. No, but that's one of the changes that I'll be making. I have little words in every one of these that are in there just to make sure we're still awake.
Yes.
But I'll make note. It's just like that whole discussion about the stone walls. There aren't any, okay? We do it just to make sure. When my lawn's mowed, it's improved.
Madam Chairman?
Councilor Linnell?
Yeah, I would only support this if it is, if we do not include the word paved. So I think Councilor Reed's on the right track. I don't want to see any paving. I like the natural state wording.
Improved. To maintain the trail. I think you'd be better off, perhaps, and be clearer if in your first sentence you have something about maintaining the existing trail in its natural state. And then the second sentence clarify that maintenance shall include and be limited to grass mowing and selective pruning.
Second. It's late, Jim.
I know. Day job kicks in. Did you get that?
Say it again.
Cape Elizabeth Town Council accepts the recommendation, I hope I'm phrasing correctly that recommendation, to maintain the existing trail along the Spurwink Estuary from the high school property to Starboard Drive in its natural state. This maintenance is to be limited. Maintenance of this municipally controlled property is to be limited to grass mowing and selective pruning.
Sounds good.
If I'm wording your correctly. Councilor Groff?
The only problem I have is I agree with everything except if we have heavy rains and part of it washes out. I mean, I'd certainly like people to be able to put gravel back and keep it maintained. So why can't we just say maintained in its natural state, including grass mowing and selective pruning?
Okay.
Good. Sorry you have to listen to this, folks, but sometimes it does produce a better product. Council.
So the intent is to drop the adjective multipurpose? Is that correct?
Paved and multipurpose have both been dropped.
Okay. That's
my understanding.
And municipally controlled was dropped too?
No, municipally controlled was still in there.
Could I speak?
Yeah, I guess we have a problem with that part. Yes, sir.
Yeah, what it said was the trail on any municipally controlled property, and the new wording says this trail is to be municipally controlled. We have no right to municipally control property that we have no control over. Some of this property is not ours. It belongs to the land trust and other parties. So if that's remaining the way I heard it, there's a problem with it.
How can we then go in and do maintenance if we don't control it? Do we have easements from those other property owners?
No, we don't. That's why the original draft said the trail in this area on any municipally controlled property. We don't have any impact on land that we don't control.
Get your pencil ready.
We may have impact, but you can.
How do you want it changed?
That whole sentence can stay with the exception of except to including, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So leave the original a trail
right.
in this area.
A trail in this area on any municipally controlled property.
Yeah, we'll do it.
The existing accepts the recommendation to whatever we said.
To maintain a trail.
To maintain the trail in this area on municipally control on the municipally controlled property in this area.
You lost with the rest of us, Debbie.
She's plugging away.
Did you read it back?
You want to read it back?
Yeah. Cable's with Town Council hereby accepts the recommendation of Pedals and Pedestrians Committee to maintain the existing trail along the Spurwink Estuary from the Cables with High School property to Starboard Drive. A trail in this area on any municipally controlled property shall be maintained in a natural state, including grass mowing and selective pruning.
Does that work for everybody?
Sounds good.
Good job. Was there a second to the motion?
Yes, I second.
Thank you, Counselor Jordan, I missed that. Counsel, comment, discussion?
Move the motion.
Thank you. All those in favor? All those opposed? 7-0. Item number 61 is a vote on the recommendation of the Pedals and Pedestrian Committee to place a sidewalk on Shore Road from Fort Williams Park to Dyer Pond Road. The draft proposed motion reads, "The Cape Elizabeth Town Council hereby requests the Fort Williams Advisory Commission to review pedestrian opportunities within Fort Williams Park near Shore Road and to review the condition of pedestrian entryways into the park from Shore Road." That does not address the sidewalk on Shore Road. Counselor Groff.
I make a motion to table this motion. I think it's getting late, and I would rather table sorted other motions and move forward to some other things that I think we have to get done tonight.
Second.
All those in favor of tabling? All those opposed? 7-0. Item number 62. Vote to request the Maine Department of Transportation to reallocate any available state and federal funds towards a traffic light and walk cycle lights at Shore Road, Route 77, and Scott Dyer Road intersection. Mr. McGovern, do you want to say anything about that?
Yes, this was funded by the state about 3.5 years ago. Subsequently, the council discussed it. They voted at the time to go ahead with the light at Spurwink, and Route 77 decided they'd like to revisit this if it was ever designed. The thinking now is that if the town center sidewalk drainage project is going to go forward, this is the time to have this project also go forward. However, meanwhile, we discovered that MDOT had suddenly evaporated the funds, and this is asking for the funds to rain down upon Cape Elizabeth again. I had to get out of evaporation.
Thank you. Counsel McGinty.
Does this essentially mean that we are going to reapply for these funds? Is that what we're talking about, reapplying for the funds? Or is there some,
we
have an in somehow that if we just kind of ask again, they'll kind of give them to us?
Yeah, we'd tell, the approach to MDOT would be, we had a grant for Shore Road for bikeways, we're not doing it. You got some loose money hanging around there. You know, make good on your promise, do it.
Counselor Cogsell.
I'll make a motion.
Thank you.
Ordered the Cape Elizabeth Town Council hereby request the Maine Department of Transportation to immediately reinstitute funds for the design and installation of traffic signals and walk lights at the intersection of Shore Road, Scott Dyer Road, and Ocean House Road. No lights are to be installed until approval of the final design by the Cape Elizabeth Town Council.
Second.
Thank you. Counselor Jordan.
I get a little disturbed if I was sitting up there and received a letter and you told me to immediately reinstitute the funds. I think you got to be a little more diplomatic about asking them to look into it again now. Maybe I'm off base, but...
I've had discussions with MDOT about this, and they're very amenable to it. I don't anticipate any problem.
Yeah, but regardless, if I received the letter up there, for you to jump immediately, maybe they're...
I'd have a nice talk with them, Counselor.
Okay.
Further discussion? Counselor Linnell.
I just want to thank Counselor Jordan. I think he's got a point there, but I'm sure that our manager will be very diplomatic when he speaks to the folks in Augusta.
Well, you're voting on the item as read, so
I'd be willing
should
to
be struck in here.
I'd be willing to amend my second if doesn't matter to me.
That's fine. He'll do it immediately anyway.
Yeah. Go ahead.
So fine.
Striking the word immediately?
Yes.
Keeping in mind, however, that they withdrew the funds without even letting us know, so.
Question has been moved. All those in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Item number 63, vote to request the Maine Department of Transportation to reallocate any available state and federal funds towards one bikeway project based on the fact that a previous agenda item favored the acceptance of one grant for a bikeway and not for two grants. Councilor Reed?
Madam Chairman, I move on item number 63, resolved, whereas by the vote of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, the town of Cape Elizabeth will not move forward with a state-approved bikeway project on Shore Road, and whereas by vote of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council voted on September 9, 1996, to move forward on the proposed bike facility on Two Lights Road, and whereas the estimated budget amount of the approved project on Two Lights Road is $45,000 less than budgeted, and whereas the town of Cape Elizabeth plans to continually address pedestrian and bike safety issues within the town of Cape Elizabeth, now therefore the Cape Elizabeth Town Council hereby requests the Maine Department of Transportation increase the grant amount for the Two Lights Road project to the August 1995 estimated amount of $165,000 plus 10% for contingency to a total of $181,500.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Thank you, Councilor McGinty. Any discussion?
Move the motion.
Thank you. All those in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Item number 64 is a vote to request the Maine Department of Transportation to reallocate any available state and federal funds toward the town center drainage and sidewalk project. Councilor Cogsill?
Ordered the Cape Elizabeth Town Council hereby request the town manager and the town council chairman to request the Maine Department of Transportation to transfer all remaining funds allocated to Cape Elizabeth for projects not approved by the town to the town center drainage and sidewalk project. Priority for the town center project is for sidewalks and drainage improvements on Scott Dyer Road and then on Ocean House Road from Scott Dyer Road to Fowler Road on the southwesterly side of Ocean House Road. Next priority is the northeasterly side of Ocean House Road from Shore Road to the Town Hall.
Thank you. Do we have a second?
I'll second.
Councilor Groff seconds. Discussion? Councilor Reed?
Yes, I fully support the first half of that. However, I will not be able to vote for the motion because I do not agree with the statement that the next priority is the northeasterly side of Ocean House Road from Shore Road to the Town Hall.
Thank you. Anybody else? Councilor Jordan?
I'm a little slow on this one, I guess, but as far as the next priority in the northeasterly side of Ocean House Road, you can't support from the Shore Road to the Town Hall when they redo the drainage there of having a sidewalk at the same time. That's what you don't support. Do you not support the drainage part or just the sidewalk part?
The expenditure of funds. That isn't where the problem is. The drainage problem, as I understand it, is into the parking lot of the shopping center.
I think your drainage problem is right underneath from where you're sitting. That runs under from the Shell station, where it used to be Shell station, under the Town Hall, into private property just beyond the fence out here. And as long as Robinson owned it, they didn't seem to be cared. But if with new owners there and if they're going to do something, I think you've got a project there that you've got to fix one of these days. And you should be thinking about it.
So the northeasterly side of Ocean House Road from Shore Road to the Town Hall would solve that problem?
Mr. McGovern?
All right, I'll support it. I'm aware of the problem. I thought it was on the other side. Thank you.
Move the motion.
Counselor Groff, thank you. All those in favor? All those opposed? 7-0. Item number 65 is a vote upon the recommendation of the Pedals and Pedestrian Committee to install sidewalks on certain collector roads. Counselor Cogsell?
I'd like to table this for our next meeting.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? 7-0 to table. Item number 66, a vote upon the recommendation of the Pedals and Pedestrian Committee to provide paved shoulders on various collector roads. Counselor Groff?
Make a motion to table this.
Second.
To when, Counselor Groff?
To the next meeting.
Thank you. Second. All those in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Item number 67. A vote upon the recommendation of the Pedals and Pedestrian Committee to provide paved shoulders on the entire length of Wells Road. Counselor Reeve.
Madam Chairman, I move we table item number 67 and 68.
About one at a time.
Second.
Right. Or one at a time.
I thought I was going to get out of one.
Oh, sorry.
Is it table for both?
Are we tabling for one or for two, Counselor?
Both of them, please.
Item number 68 is a vote upon the recommendation from Pedals and Pedestrian Committee relating to greenbelt facilities. Motion is to table both of them. There is a second. All those in favor? All those opposed? Both tabled. 7-0. Item number 69, vote to authorize the town manager to procure engineering services for the reconstruction of Pleasant Avenue.
Yeah, we would like to really get this started. We've received a petition from the residents there, and they're in dire need of work to be done on the road.
Could you please explain, if the motion goes forward as presented, what the timing would be?
The timing would be that the engineering would begin this fall, would have public meetings in the spring, and the construction would begin after July 1, but very soon after July 1 of 1997, in order to ensure that it was completed in the construction season of 1997.
Thank you. 20-year lapse. Counselor Jordan?
A question to the manager. Does that mean when you speak of doing Pleasant Avenue, you're thinking of the whole length of it and no temporary situation at that?
That's right. Drainage and total reconstruction.
I understand it all needs to be done, but they have a poor situation down there by the sag. Okay.
Councilor McGinty?
I'd like to know from the town manager where Pleasant Avenue fits in on the five-year roadway plan.
It's right now it's competing with Tide's Edge for the top of the list.
The top of the list.
Councilor Linnell?
I just want to ask the town manager. It says engineering design. Is that that's just engineering? And is that right?
And construction plans.
Okay. And how long is Pleasant Avenue about? Anybody?
Maybe 2 to 3/10 of a mile.
Okay. It seems like a bargain. Thank you, Mr. Manager.
Councilor Reed.
Madam Chairman, for item number 69, be it ordered that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council hereby allocates a sum not to exceed $10,000 from the roadway drainage account for engineering design for the reconstruction of Pleasant Avenue.
Second motion.
Thank you. Any discussion? All those in favor? All those opposed? 7-0. Item number 70. Is vote to authorize the town manager to procure engineering services for improvement of drainage patterns on Shore Road near Tide's Edge Road.
We had a previous discussion on this evening, and we would like to get the engineering going on that so we have a finite cost estimate so then we can decide which goes first, Pleasant Avenue. I think Pleasant Avenue's got to go first anyway, it's far less, but Tide's Edge, we've been flooding those people's lots, and there was some, I don't know if they're still here, there was someone here early tonight who owns a house there that it just floods all over into that area, so it does need to be done.
Thank you. Counselor Reed?
Being sensitive to houses that flood with town water, I would like to have item number 70 say that it is ordered that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council hereby allocates a sum not to exceed $10,000 from the roadway drainage account for engineering design for drainage improvements near the intersection of Shore Road and Tide's Edge Road.
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? Passes 7-0. Item number 71 is vote to formally allocate $150,000 of previously approved funds for improvements to the town center drainage patterns and for sidewalks on Scott Dyer Road and on Route 77 between the Scott Dyer Road Shore Road intersection and Fowler Road. Mr. McGovern?
This is the town share of grants that you previously applied for, one of which you have already accepted.
Thank you. Counselor Cogsell?
Ordered the town council, Cape Elizabeth Town Council hereby allocates a sum not to exceed $150,000 from the roadway drainage account for the local share of the town center drainage and sidewalk project. Priority for the town center project is for sidewalks and drainage improvements on Scott Dyer Road and then on Ocean House Road from Scott Dyer Road to Fowler Road on the southwesterly side of Ocean House Road. Next priority is the northeasterly side of Ocean House Road from Shore Road to the town hall.
Thank you. Councilor Reed?
I'm not going to, I'll second, and then may I comment?
Certainly.
I just think it's appropriate to ask the question what the entire project share is and to notify the public that this is an 85-15 split of federal money to state and local.
Total cost?
We've had estimates up to $1.2 million.
Thank you.
A lot of it involved with the drainage.
Councilor Linnell?
Thank you. Yeah, I'm just wondering, thinking out loud, if it'd be more appropriate to spend $150,000 on one of those other roads, Fowler Road or somewhere down there, somewhere else in town.
My understanding is if we do not allocate the local share, we do not get the match, the 85% match.
I see. Thank you.
Councilor McGinty?
We had a previous item regarding the design and installation of a signal out here at Scott Dyer Shore and 77.
Yes, sir.
How does this fit in with installation of these current sidewalks? Are we going to put in these sidewalks and then get a design and engineering study back from MDOT that says we got to move them? How is that going to work?
We're trying to piece all of this together. That's why they're both appearing on your agenda.
So you're saying we would wait till we get the design for the intersection regarding the tri-light signal before we would actually construct the sidewalks in that area?
We would get all the final designs concurrently, and you would be approached to approve the final designs concurrently.
I think that's...
As well as a change in the speed limit, which is another issue that you received an earlier memo on here at the town center, because otherwise you get into all sorts of problems with curb radii and other issues.
I think that's one reason that we have not taken action previously on that traffic signal grant money. Anybody else? All those in favor? All those... wait a minute here. Okay, all those in favor, excuse me. All those opposed? 7-0 in favor. That concludes the items that were under road, bikeway, sidewalks, and path issues. We move on to another compendium of issues entitled Playing Fields.
Madam Chairman.
Councilor Cogsell.
Yes, I'd like to move to take an item out of order.
Yes, ma'am.
I move that we take item number 76 out of order, that I believe this is an integral part of the approval of the playing fields, and that would be the proposed wording from the Fort Williams Park Working Group on dedication of the southerly section of Fort Williams Park.
Thank you. Is there a second on that?
I'll second that.
Okay, item 76. Oh, we need to vote on whether or not to take it out of order. I'm sorry. All those in favor of taking this item out of order? All those opposed? Vote is 7-0. Okay. Councilor Cogswell.
Yes, my reason for wanting to take this out of order is because I do feel that 2 months ago, when we first discussed this, a group came forward with a proposal that, even though they did not approve of a multi-purpose playing field in Fort Williams Park, they would not pursue blocking its construction if we would be willing to dedicate permanently the southern section of the park for passive and informal recreation. The council formed a working group that consisted of 2 members of the Friends of Fort Williams Park, 2 members from the Fort Williams Advisory Committee, 2 members from the Planning Board, and 2 councilors, the chairman and myself. And we had many long meetings, and 3 very long meetings, and finally came up with a proposal. And I think it behooves us to, as a council, to consider the policy statement at the same time we're approving the ball fields, because I think that there was a certain sense of trust that was given that we would do something to try to maintain a balance in that particular area. So I'm not sure, since this hadn't been set for public hearing, that we can really, you want to take public comment on this as well at this time, or shall I just make a motion on the policy statement?
My intent was to open it up. We do have 2 advertised public hearings, and my intent was to open it up for public comment on issues 72, 73, 74, 75, and 76, which does include this.
May I, for the benefit of those who don't know what this is, read this recommendation?
Certainly.
There was, it sort of was broken down into 2 sections. Section A is a policy statement. Be it ordered, the Cape Elizabeth Town Council does hereby permanently dedicate the southerly section of Fort Williams Park for the exclusive use of informal and passive recreation as defined below. The following exceptions are allowed: a multi-purpose playing field as approved by the Cape Elizabeth Town Council on September 9, 1996, temporary storage of materials within the park maintenance area. Current uses may continue but not be expanded. Then it goes on to definitions. As part B, there is the implementation of this policy, which would be forwarded for comment to the Fort Williams Advisory Committee, as well as the Planning Board, and come back to the Council. It's done in 3 different steps. 1 is an ordinance change in the Fort Williams Park District section of the ordinance, 1968. The second would be an amendment to the master plan of Fort Williams Park, dated 1190. And the third would be an amendment to the statement of policy of Fort Williams Park that was adopted by the Town Council October 25, 1976. Also, as part of the approval, would be the adoption of a presented plan that outlines this whole integral area that we describe as being the southerly section of the fort, which runs from the shoreline down along the parking lot that we call the central parking lot, out to Shore Road, along Shore Road, and along the Delano Park fence line.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Councilor Reed?
I have several concerns, and one is the reference to the fact that we've already approved the multipurpose ball field by the statement, and we haven't had it yet by taking it out of order. I'm also very concerned about the reference to preliminary accepts. It has been the policy of the town council repeatedly to never accept but only to receive policy changes until after the full Fort Williams Advisory Commission and Planning Board have reviewed this. It's my understanding that neither one of those groups have, and I just want you to know I will not be voting to support this as a condition of approval.
Okay, thank you. As I previously stated, we do have two public hearings within this grouping of issues, and I would like at this time to open the floor to the public, as we did with the previous grouping of issues, asking those who would like to speak to this issue to keep your comments concise. We are all aware of the lateness of the hour, and please line up at the lectern. That does speed things along for us, and we would be glad to hear your comments, but again, please keep them concise and non-redundant. Thank you. Is there anybody who wants to speak to this?
Do you want me to explain the funding proposal?
Excuse me. I'm sorry. The manager would like to explain the funding proposal, which is part of, which is item number 75.
I don't wish to hold you up, but since you may have questions on it, I thought it might be helpful. I worked with the Cape Elizabeth Little League Leadership Group, which also includes the Casco Bay Soccer Club and Field for Cape Kids. As everyone knows, this field's proposed, all the Fort Williams has got the attention, but there's also Little League Field proposed for Lions Field, as well as the multi-purpose soccer, lacrosse, field hockey playing field at Fort Williams Park. The proposal is the town would contribute $150,000. It would come from the town's undesignated surplus. The town's undesignated surplus is currently $1,250,000. The private share would also be $150,000. The Little League and the youth soccer groups would have a pledge of $40,000 that would be paid over 5 years. There'd be in-kind donations, construction equipment, et cetera, $50,000, and fundraising of $60,000 for a total project cost for both the Lions Field project and the Fort Williams Park project of $300,000. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now we would like to hear from the public.
My name is Richard Hall. I live in Reef Road, Cape Elizabeth. I have put three children through our school system here, gone and grown, and I am speaking in support of the multi-purpose field. We bought Fort Williams quite a few years ago, and we've been hosts to South Portland, Scarborough. They use our facilities. We supply the police force. If you leave the Cape Courier, you see that many things happen in the fort. It's our police force that takes care of the problem at cost to you and me. So it's about time this town started using the fort for our own purposes and not so much for let everybody in the public from all the different towns use it. The Oaks, they have ballparks down there in Portland Oaks. They seem to get along fine with the Oaks. The Oaks hasn't changed since I was a kid. Still a beautiful park. I don't think this multi-purpose field will hurt this park at all, and I'm 100% for it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hall.
My name is Richard Berman, and I live at 1021 Shore Road. And I was part of that Fort Williams working group, so I support this compromise. There's been a lot of work, a lot of faith, a lot of good trust in forging this compromise. In approving all those items, I would look at item number 76. I think I would like to see this council change the wording so that it read the Cape Elizabeth Town Council adopt the policy statement drafted by the Fort Williams Park Working Group, and the implementation of the policy as drafted be referred to the Fort Williams Advisory Commission and the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board for comments, all comments to be received by December 15th. The reason I say that is we have gone through a process. Fort Williams Advisory Board had at least two or three meetings that I attended processing this and giving direction to their two representatives to the working group. The Friends of Fort Williams had many meetings giving directions to their representatives of the fort, of the working group, and I also believe the Planning Board did. We've processed this thing. It is time to take action. It's very important to a large contingency of the citizens in this community to say, all right, let's have the multi-purpose field, but no more in this section. That's very, very important. We've processed it to death. We've come up with something that I think we've had consensus on. It's time to move that question. And so I would urge you, as part of this deliberation, to adopt the policy and then just forward the implementation for feedback. Thank you. Oh, one other thing I would like to point out, and this is just in the findings of facts for this. And I just want to clarify one thing. This is under, I guess it'd be under, I don't know the reading, 4A and B and C and D. This, a lot of language there.
Can you tell me what line you're on, please?
I think it's line 284.
Thank you.
And it reads, A, the area of the park in which a field shall be located is not now improved for park or recreational use. You know that language? And for the period contemplated by such proposed period, the area of the park is not anticipated to become the subject of any viable proposal for park or recreational improvements. The next one says the proposed use will not interfere with or to detract from park and recreation uses then existing or anticipated during the period of such use. I would like to see that clarified. Right now it is improved, the meadow is mowed, it is used, it's an active dog running area of the park, it's used for walking, it's used for informal and passive recreation presently. So that I think that the findings A and B are incorrect. And I wanted to point that out to you so that you might amend that, because it is right now being used for passive and informal recreation, and it is being improved and maintained by the town. So I would urge you again, just in conclusion, to look at this holistically and to approve the policy of no more after this multi-use field, to preserve the rest of that southern area with those exclusions as drafted permanently. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Berman.
I'm Carol Haas from 6 Loxley Road. I think this is my third time now before the council discussing playing fields at Fort Williams. I don't want to belabor the point as whether those of us who care about that part of the park have a right to a sense of a personal sacred place about it. We've gone through that one. I ask your respect that even if we might not be the same religion, that we have our sacred places and you have yours. I will support the compact as we discussed in the last time we went through this. The compact, I'm on a different issue here. I'll support this compromise program as pretty much as written, but I have an observation to make. The change to the ordinance, which now uses permitted in the southerly section of Fort Williams Park, A, passive recreational activities, B, one multi-purpose playing field only. You know, the ordinance used to read passive recreational activities, and that was it. And then someone decided they wanted to do something else. And now here we are. Now it says passive recreational activities and one multi-purpose playing field only. And I don't feel assured by the way this is written that 3 years from now someone won't decide we need to add C, swimming pool, or C, riding rink or something. In other words, to me, the wording of the dedication is not strong enough, because I have seen the council change the ordinance when they felt that they needed or wanted to do so. You know, there are many of us that feel that it should still be passive recreational activities only, and this is a real stretch for us to go that now we have to have a B1 multipurpose playing field, and we really don't want to have a C and a D every time somebody decides that they have a good idea of how to use the fort. Thanks.
Thank you, Ms. Hatz.
Carol Fritz, 9 Hunt Club Road. I hope this draws to a close the strongly held disagreement that we have had in this town about locating fields at Fort Williams for active sports. I'd like to commend Councilor Groff for his proposal to have the Little League field in a different location than Fort Williams. We are a group that oppose active fields at Fort Williams. However, we are willing, in order to avoid a contentious battle, to go along with a soccer field if the council is willing at the same time to vote to permanently preserve tonight the southern area for informal and passive recreation. We have worked with the council on the conditions and the Fort Williams committee for using the field, and we are in agreement as far as they go. We have worked in good faith, Richard and I, on the ad hoc working group to work out the wording to present to you tonight. The working group that was set up by the town council and the manager to work on this. And I urge you to approve that wording reached in consensus by the group. After all, it was a group made up of the council, the Fort Williams committee, the planning board, and the Friends of Fort Williams. And I think we did come to consensus, and that consensus is to permanently preserve that small area of the fort that has a field, an active field in the middle of it. We had three meetings, meeting at 7:30 and 7 o'clock in the morning for several hours with that group. I hope that you will vote to approve that wording tonight along with the field proposal. I really don't relish the idea of having a referendum on this issue. I have lots of other things I want to do with my life. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Fritz.
Madam Chair, may I ask?
Counselor. Councilor Reed?
May I ask the Speaker a question, please?
Certainly. Mrs. Fritz, if you could come back, please.
Just, Carolyn, your use of the word contentious battle, could you please elaborate?
Well, I think we have had a lot of disagreement about this issue. If you cannot vote to preserve the area tonight, I think that we are ready to go to a referendum. And the referendum would not be what we have had consensus on. It would probably be on no fields at all.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
My name's John Chapman. I live at 77 Hillcrest Road. First, I want to just call the council's attention to one. I think it's probably a technical matter. I don't know if it's an oversight or if it was intentional. In item 75, paragraph 3, dealing with funding, it states any funds remaining after the design costs and legal expenses are paid, any funds remaining shall be allocated individually to the two projects with 50% going to each. For our part, I would hope to see, or for myself, I would hope to see funding not 50-50, but in proportion to the costs. I think the costs, as they're broken down, are $188,000 for the Lions Field project and $111,000 for the Fort Williams project. So if some consideration could be given to the percentage. Second, with respect to the Fort Williams Park Working Group's recommendation, I'm not clear in my own mind right now to what extent you're going to consider that tonight. As I understand that group's conclusions, They are not proposing that the current field at Officers Row be closed down. And if there is any suggestion of that, at least the Little League would find that to be an unfortunate result. What this has been about for the last 2 years has been not just building nicer and bigger and better fields, but adding additional fields for the kids of the town. Losing a field while gaining one more does not really give us any net benefit at all. Finally, I just want to say that the overall proposal, the package of proposals that you have before you tonight, is an extremely good one. It's a product of an enormous amount of thoughtful deliberation by, I think, every member of this council. It is a recognition that kids, that it's good for kids to have a place to play, and that it's good policy to give kids a place to play. I think this package of proposals is also a proper recognition that Fort Williams is a sacred place to the people of the town of Cape Elizabeth. This is a modest proposal for building fields at Fort Williams. It is as unobtrusive and non-destructive of Fort Williams as possibly could happen. This is overall a package, I think, that this council can feel good about, that you can feel good that you're doing the right thing for the kids of this town. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Chapman.
My name is Roy Dunphy. I reside in 23 Columbus Road. I'm the director of fields for Casco Bay Soccer Club. And I'd like to urge you to support the multipurpose field at Fort Williams and the ball field at Lions Field. And I'd also concerned about the items on the item 76 here by the proposed Fort Williams Park Working Group. On definition there, on the informal and passive recreation, it seems that there is a definite distinction trying not to involve any team sport, which sort of confusing on me. I'd like to have that defined a little more. If several kids are playing with a soccer ball or baseball, is that considered a team sport and the park ranger should remove them? But he can play with a frisbee, is all right. I mean, I don't understand why we have a park for the town and the children and we're putting restrictions on it. I think that should be a little less restrictive there. And the other thing is there's northern area of the park, and I was wondering why the southern area is any special than the northern area. Is this just designated open space, and isn't that enough? Do we have to come with more restrictions because it's near a certain neighborhood? I don't fathom any of that. So I'd like you to take a close look at that item before you approve it. Thank you.
Madam Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Duffy. Mr. Councilor McKinney.
Could I ask a question before you?
Certainly.
Regarding comments made by Mr. Chapman regarding item 75 about the proportional expense as opposed to 50-50.
Yes, we're in agreement on that. Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Duffy. Yes, sir.
Madam Chair, members of the council, my name is John Delahanty. I live at Manaway. And I guess I've been fortunate to have missed the previous meetings concerning this issue, but I felt an obligation to my children to come here this evening. I have done a lot of traveling in Maine, and I think that this town, by any municipal standards, is blessed by a significant amount of green space, open space, whatever you might wish to call it. We have dedicated green belts, easements, public lands that many towns don't have. We also have significant amount of lands and large land ownerships, which, at least for the foreseeable future, will never be developed. I think we have a lot of open space to provide for informal, passive recreation, but we don't have a sports fields for our kids. This is especially so when we compare ourselves to towns such as Falmouth, Cumberland, Scarborough, and I only think of the Dominicus Crossing coming, where I think there's an estimated 85 children in 97 houses or so. I'm not quite sure that's in line with what I see with developments around Cape Elizabeth. Personally, I think, and everyone would agree, a lot of work has gone into this entire proposal. Personally, and those folks should be certainly commended. But personally, I believe this town should take a comprehensive look at all its fields, and I've especially drawn to the baseball field at the high school. The other fields around the high school, I think, are in very tough condition. I certainly believe that the town should add fields, and personally, I favor the original plan that would allow a Little League field and a multi-purpose field at Fort Williams and the development of Lions Field, I believe, at less cost, and use the remaining monies to try to upgrade some of the other fields around this town or to develop the pond at Lions Fields into at least an adequate skating facility for the children of the town. I take a look at Scarborough, which has a wonderful facility. I know a lot has discussion has gone into this, and I'm certainly not going to prolong it. And I'm certainly hopeful that this council will act this evening to provide more fields for our children in Cape Elizabeth. They certainly are our most precious resource. With regard to an item, and I don't have the piece of paper that I believe Councillor Cogshaw was reading from concerning the dedication of the southerly portion, I'm not sure I would favor something that would say permanently dedicate a portion of that park. Granted, the future councils can change something, but I believe there certainly needs to be flexibility in any particular facility such as Fort Williams. And I believe there may also be a question with regard to certain uses in that area of the park. I hope those are not changed at this particular time. But in summary, I certainly hope that this council sees fit to provide additional fields for our children and also looks forward to upgrading the present fields that we presently have. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Delahanty. Is there anybody else from the public who would like to speak on this? Councilor Cogshaw?
Madam Chairman, thank you. I just wanted to let Mr. Delahanty know that the town council has directed the Community Service Advisory Commission to start taking a comprehensive look at all of our recreational facilities and options in the town. So that started. It's a long process, but it has begun.
Thank you. Okay. There is a council. I'm sorry, ma'am. Excuse me.
Surprise.
You weren't there the last time I looked.
Nancy Masterton, 56 Wildwood Drive, formerly of Delano Park. I really didn't want to speak on this tonight, and I must say, standing here, I feel like the institutional memory of Fort Williams. When we first moved here, it was a fort. And I can remember having a very pleasant evening when somebody took us to the officers' club. But living next door to it, I have a very fond feeling for the park. And what I'm going to urge you to do is please do accept the compromise. I think that the permanent preservation of the southern end of the park, with the exception of the soccer field, should be adopted by the council. That's a compromise. There are people in this town who feel very strongly about walking their dogs, just having the peace and quiet of that section of the park. And we've heard how we have lent that park to the people of this region, and in fact from all over the world. And so for those people who live here in the Cape and want to walk their dogs and want to be in that part of the park in peace and quiet, I think you should encourage them to do so, and I think you should give them the opportunity to be able to do so. So I do urge you to adopt the compromise. Thanks.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Michael Roy, 51 Hillcrest Road. I just had a question as to process. When I read the agenda items for this evening, I saw item 76 as a report of progress of working group on southerly section of Fort Williams Park. And then in the process of moving this item up the agenda, a motion was made by Councilor Coggeshall to basically accept the report of that working group and then, I guess, pass it along to the Fort Williams Advisory Committee, and I'm not sure who else, but...
The planning board.
Right. Is that the process that the town council normally follows, or should those committees, those advisory boards, have an initial review of this document and then have it come back after that review? It seems to me that's the way things usually work around here. And where this was supposed to be just a report on the progress of that working group, I'm wondering how we're suddenly talking about this becoming the document that we're going to work from in dealing with
the process section. You have alluded to is the standard operating procedure. However, any counselor can make a motion that does not follow that process. That's entirely in line for that kind of motion to be made. Is there anybody else from the public?
I'm Marion Guthrie, and I live at 8 Delano Park. And no one has mentioned how happy we all are about the field, the baseball field at Lions Field. Everyone seems to be talking about the soccer field. But I would just like to say that I think it's great, and I hope it will go forward. As a former high school English teacher, recreation director, Cub Scout den mother, and soccer coach of 10-year-old boys, and as a mother of two sons, I love children of all ages. But I also love Fort Williams Park. I guess that sounds a little emotional, but some of the best people I know have a perfect balance of emotions and intellect. But I want to see the unique character of that park preserved for future generations of children of all ages. It really has nothing to do with a certain neighborhood. It has to do with a beautiful park. I am opposed to any plan that does not include a permanent dedication of the remainder of the southern section, lest the park go piece by piece to complete development. I think Mr. McGinty alluded to that in our town tonight. If the council is not prepared to vote on that dedication tonight, then I urge you to table the soccer field until you are ready to vote on a more complete plan for the whole area. Since the last town election, we have been aware that the majority of this council will vote in favor of development of the field at the park before this public hearing ever occurred tonight. Now, please listen to all of the people, or this public hearing will be rendered a farce, and we will all wonder why we bothered to come here tonight, or why we should bother to come in the future. Cape Elizabeth town councilors are elected to represent all of the people and to listen with open minds to all of their constituents. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mrs. Guthrie. Is there anybody else from the public who would like to speak on this? Thank you. We have a council rule that we do not take up new items after 11 o'clock. If we are to proceed, I need a motion to that effect, otherwise we will stand adjourned.
So moved.
Second.
That's to waive the way the town council.
Some people are tacking up.
I'm not sure if you said the whole thing.
Suspension of the rules.
Suspension of the rules.
All those in favor? Opposed? 7-0. We will continue. Counselor Cogswell?
Yes, are we about to discuss these motions? I wanted to answer a few questions that were offered up by some of these the speakers. Mm-hmm. While it is not always the general practice to, well, it is, the council can adopt a policy statement and then forward it to following different committees to get the backup information, i.e. changing of plans and ordinances, if we so deem. It is well within our purview tonight to preliminarily accept this policy statement and then forward to these other advisory committees for their comments and also their reaction to the different implementation steps. We can, and we have, as Mr. Berman commented, spent excessive time working on this proposed wording. We had representatives from all the committees. We met 1 week, 2 week layover, 1 week and 1 week. There was plenty of time to get feedback, and I know they did have conversations with their respective committees. And I feel that it would be a breach of faith and of trust if we don't preliminarily approve the policy statement and then forward this to the other committees. And I did have a motion that was approved to take this out of order.
Yes, you did.
So I am going to make a motion that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council hereby preliminarily approves the policy statement from the Fort Williams Park Working Group in permanently dedicating the southerly section of Fort Williams Park.
Why don't you finish that sentence? You're permanently dedicating the southerly section of Fort Williams Park.
What?
To what? Permanently dedicating the...
Oh, I'm sorry. It's late.
Yes, it is.
I've said it so many times, the use of informal and passive recreation as presented in this statement.
Are you including the exceptions that are
with
presented?
With the exceptions, right. That's part of the policy statement. You want me to read it off?
I just wanted to make sure.
It's the whole policy statement.
Everything?
With the exceptions.
Thank you.
Including the definitions below.
Thank you. Do we have a second?
I have a question before we have a second. Can I ask a question then?
Yes, you may.
Councilor Cogswell. The way this is worded, it has the multi-purpose playing field already approved. I mean, how do we vote on this that says that reference to playing field that's already been approved if we haven't approved the playing field yet? And the other question I have, perhaps you can answer, it has current uses may continue but not be expanded. I assume that language means that the AA field is there currently would continue since that's a current use. Is that correct?
That was the consensus of the group, that it would continue and then hopefully be phased out.
Because I want to clearly understand that I have absolutely no problem and at the last meeting having this be implemented. I just want to make sure we do it right. That's all.
Well, I can see why you're saying about the multi-purpose playing field. I just feel that we need to approve. Perhaps we leave the dates off and then go back later and add the dates.
Do it that way.
Can I make another?
This is a preliminary approval, too.
If you could please clarify what you mean by preliminary approval.
Preliminary means that we'll have a final vote on it when we get all the feedback from our respective committees.
And there could be substantive changes proposed and voted on at that time?
Yes.
Councilor Linnell?
I'm just thinking, why don't we wait follow the process. I am very sensitive to the concerns of the people for that area of the park, and I said so last time we talked about this. And however, I am concerned that we are putting the cart before the horse if we do this tonight. I think we should go through Fort Williams Advisory Commission and the Planning Board. That's what they're there for. We listen to the people here tonight. I think we need to listen to their concerns in terms of fine-tuning it. I can't help but notice the irony that we are willing to sort of bind future councils in perpetuity when we've been reluctant to commit ourselves a month or two down the road. Be that as it may, I think the working group has some very genuine concerns, and I think there's generally I would tend to support them, and I'll go on record as saying that, but I would feel more comfortable if we went through the process. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Jordan?
No, I'm thinking along the same line, wondering why we are picking this up out of order to move it on ahead of the others, why we aren't taking them the fields. If I don't quite understand all this, because some of that's in this pertains to the field as far as the storage goes. They're going to have a storage area? They're going to use a building within that area, aren't they? They're not going to haul that equipment back and forth.
They already do store things at the fort. They already use some of the fort buildings for storage down there.
It should be spelled out. I think
the storage has to do with the Public Works Department being able to, and that's explained in your definitions. And there is a precedent for permanently dedicating part of the space at the fort, which was done in 1976. Where the whole shoreline area has been dedicated. I do agree, however, that perhaps I'm a little ahead of the cart, behind the cart, whatever, as far as trying to have it specifically relate to the approval of this field. However, I think the process is not being violated by preliminarily approving this policy statement. I think it shows trust and good faith on the part of the council that we're going to try to forward this. However, I would be willing to let this motion follow in its normal process of being item number 76 after 70, whatever. So I'm withdrawing my motion. Right?
Thank you. I just turned to scribble. All right, we will proceed with item 72, which is a vote upon the approval of the use of Fort Williams Park for a multi-use playing field. Let us get everybody on the right page here.
Yeah. Madam Chairman, on that item in the drafting, I made an error, and that first order belongs in another item.
Thank
so
you.
Line 245 in the draft should begin ordered.
Where are we?
Okay, and the prior ordered relates to a later item and shouldn't be there.
Boy, that clears up some confusion in my mind. Thank you. Everybody following that?
No.
The first paragraph under 72, the ordered lines 235 to 242 don't belong in this item. They belong
Oh, that's right. That's the Lions Field.
In item number 74.
Cut and paste works well until you paste too much.
I will say the use of numbered lines has been very helpful in this length of document. We have a motion. Councilor Groff?
I make a motion that we approve item number 72. If I read this motion, we're going to be here quite a while. Can I just reference that it is
the first paragraph.
Lines Fort Williams Multi-Park, Fort Williams Park Multi-Use Field, item 72, as contained in the draft motion provided by the town manager?
Specify the lines, because we...
Omitting.
It would be...
45.
245 through...
348, 349.
348.
Second.
Is there anybody who would like to have that read? Counselor Reed?
No, I have a question on line 345. I believe that stone walls should be the plural.
Is that acceptable, Counselor Groff?
Absolutely, it should be the plural.
Acceptable to the second?
Yes.
Thank you. Anything else? Counsel discussion?
That's right.
Counselor Jordan?
No, I just want to say to the people out there, I've had quite a few telephone calls today. I don't know why. I was outside and my wife took down yes and no's and whatever you want. And I'm going to support this field because I don't think some of the people that called understood just what was taking place. They felt that, the ones that I talked to, that they would be nets, backstops, and all such stuff as that up there. And in the memo that they got, a flyer, I got some calls right after the flyer come out. I hadn't even got mine, but somebody knew something that I didn't, so. Once I talked to the ones that got me and explained what the idea was and what's going to take place, they would say, oh, that sounds better to me. And they'll be able to still walk around there. If nobody was having a game or flying a kite, I guess they could walk across it. I don't think there's going to be off limits to them, is the way I put it. And there's just one question that I have, and reading what was to take place in item 76, is where they're going to store their equipment that they have over there to play soccer and what have you with. And somebody got some idea in line that there's a building, a part of a building that they can use? I'll ask the manager.
Yeah. The intent is that the soccer goalpost and those things could stay on the field, but they'd be movable. Whether or not they choose to move them in or each time is not resolved in this issue. We do have a number of those old long, that big old long garage, and we make that available to these different groups. We do it now, and we also have made available to Little League the whole upstairs, or most of the upstairs of the Parks Maintenance Building, but I quite frankly don't want a long-term commitment to that. It is extremely valuable space that is not getting a good utilization. We also do have, and it's left open in the item 76, is that's, I think it's still left open, that steel frame of a building, eventually would like to encapsulate that so that could be a storage building as well. But I'm not saying it would go towards soccer, lacrosse, and field hockey.
So that would be allowed when we vote on 76?
I think we have to see what the language is on item number 76.
We don't want to debate that now.
The storage in the long buildings would still be allowed, yeah. On Ed's in item 76.
Well, I just want to make sure it's handy, so they're not going to drag them to the edge of the field and leave them there. They're going to take care of them or not be there, is the type attitude that I have. Because the next thing, they'll be left in the field, whoever used them last.
Thank you. Counselor McGinty?
I think it was Mr. Berman who raised a question about the language at line 284.
Yes, sir.
And now I've read it, maybe, it's obviously getting late. I've read it a couple of times, and I'm not sure I understand exactly if it's correct or not.
Yes. Counselor McGinty, the zoning ordinance specifically requires that if you approve any new use within Fort Williams, that you make these four findings. And this is the wording taken straight from the zoning ordinance.
Is it in the zoning ordinance?
Yeah, the town attorney drafted this based on the language in the zoning ordinance.
Okay, it just,
need to make
it almost seems like it doesn't make much sense. It says that it's that it's not now improved, and the area of the park is not anticipated to become a subject of any viable proposal for park or recreational improvement. Isn't that in fact what we're doing?
Except the whole gist of the ordinance was that you'd want to have park and recreational improvements. So this language was really here for a new use other than that. But yet, you know, if once it was determined that this field was a new use, you were still stuck with this language. This was, you know, in essence saying that, you know, say someone had wanted to put condominiums out there, which was one proposal at one point, you would have had to have made this finding. This, when the ordinance was written, it never surmised that you'd have to go through the new use provision for a recreational use. So meanwhile, you're stuck with having to make this finding for recreational use simply because the language is there.
Okay. Councilor Coxell?
Yes, I too received many calls from individuals who were in full support of the playing field at Fort Williams Park, but really hesitated on the permanent dedication of the remainder of that space until I explained to them that this was a compromise between the people who were for the field and those who were not for the field, and that it still allowed continued use of that area that is now enjoyed by everyone. And when they heard that explanation, their resistance to the idea of permanent dedication just sort of evaporated. They felt that that was it was a compromise, that it was a sound trade-off, that it was meeting everybody's needs that way. And I will vote for this field based on that context, that if we can't have a specific policy statement not supporting this field, I'll have to reconsider my vote.
Thank you. Is there anybody else? Could we have a roll call vote, please?
Councilor Cogswell?
Based on my previous statement, yes.
Councilor Groff?
Yes.
Councilor Jordan?
Yes.
Councilor Linnell?
Yes.
Councilor McGinty?
Yes.
Councilor Reed?
Yes.
Chairman McLaughlin?
Yes.
Passes 7-6.
7-0. Thank you. Items number 73, 74, and 75, in one fashion or another, were tabled at the July council meeting. I need a motion to remove them from the table and also to renumber them as presented in this evening's agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. All those in favor? Thank you.
Madam Chairman,
sir.
How about on line 235 under item 72? When are we doing that?
That's item number.
And what's that part of what item?
Is part of
74.
Item.
Where is that?
We may need a new item number for that.
That would go under item 74.
That's part of. So on page, on line 235 to 242, that's part of item 74, a continuation of?
No,
the beginning, isn't it?
Beginning of item 74?
It would be the beginning.
Okay.
You have to approve the field before you're authorized funds for it, or it could become a separate item.
That's fine. Thank you.
Okay. Okay. Next on the agenda is item number 73, which is a vote to authorize funds for the final design and permit processes for Fort Williams, for the Fort Williams Park multi-use playing field. Okay, I'm sorry. Okay. Do you have a motion on that? Counselor Reed?
Madam Chairman, be it ordered that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council does hereby authorize the use of town funds for obtaining final engineering design and all required permits for the Fort Williams Park multi-use playing field. An amount of $150,000 is hereby appropriated from the town's undesignated fund balance. This appropriation shall also be used as provided. I don't think four has to be there. As provided in item number 75-96/97.
Thank you.
Second.
Any discussion?
Call the motion.
Thank you. All those in favor? All those opposed? 7-0. Item number 74 is a vote to authorize the approval of, let me make sure I include all that we need to here. Of the use of Lions Field for an additional ball field to be built in conformance with the design standards for Little League Baseball, and to authorize funds for the final design and permit processes for the Lions Field, the Little League style field. Councilor Groff?
So I understand that what you're saying is that line 235 through 242 and line 359 through 363 is the sum and total of the motion?
Yes, sir.
Fine.
That's of the item.
Of the item. And I will so move.
Second.
Thank you. Discussion?
Ready for the vote?
All those in favor? All those opposed? 7-0. Item number 75 is a vote to allocate funds for the provision of fields at Fort Williams Park and at Lions Field. Mr. McGovern, do you have any further explanation?
No. Yeah, when I had drafted this, I hadn't seen the proposal from the Little League Soccer group, and the proposal made by Mr. Chapman that it be proportional rather than 50% is fine.
Madam Chairman, could I give the language to make of that specific modification to line 375 so that we have a, I think the language would be, any funds remaining shall be allocated individually to the two projects, with any funds allocated to the two fields in proportion to the amount needed to reach funding goals for each project.
We'll see what the clerk comes up with. He's got it.
Is that a motion?
I think there was a little bit of redundancy that may be confusing.
Well, I think you have to talk about funding goals, because if somebody dedicates part of the money to one goal and you reach it, then you have to be done with that. And I think this language, meeting with Mr. Chapman before, satisfies everyone's concerns.
That's a motion. I'll second that.
The motion would be item 75, which is allocation of funds for field design and construction, going from line 365 to 380 with the modification of language that I previously articulated.
Could you articulate that again, please?
The modification?
Yes, please.
Paragraph 3 would read, any funds remaining shall be allocated individually to the two projects with any funds allocated to the two fields in proportion to the amount needed to reach funding goals for each project.
I was concerned the first time I heard it that it might have rewarded poor fundraising, but the second time I heard it, I didn't hear that.
Sometimes we need to. Time to process. We have a motion and a second, I believe.
So the remainder of that paragraph is left in the motion.
That's correct.
Is making the determination, may recognize pledges and organize groups, provided all such pledges are to be committed to be paid within 5 years of the date of the pledge. That's all remains in the motion.
Yes, sir.
Move the question.
Okay, thank you. All those in favor? All those opposed? 7-0. Thank you.
I know it's very late, but I would just like to underline that's from organized groups only. We will not be recognizing pledges from individuals as being supportive of the reaching any goal.
Okay.
We're going to take the money, though.
Oh, yes.
Pledges. We can't have someone say they're going to pledge and give in 2 or 3 years. Yes, if it's from one of these organized groups, but not from individuals, because that way the town could easily get stuck holding the ball unintentionally.
Well, before we do that,
I lost
something I need. Do we need an item to authorize acceptance of funds raised by outside groups?
Unless I hear objection from the council that we're not to continue to accept money, I will assume that your vote in early 1995 still holds.
We're working out something procedural that was tabled in July.
What was the wording?
The wording at that point was to reauthorize the town to accept funds for multipurpose playing fields. And we thought, and we talked about it this morning, that if we put it into that we just included that. We're all set. Thank you. I just want to get our procedures in line. Jeez. Now, item number 76. Consider a report, a progress report from the working group on the southerly section of Fort Williams Park. Councilor Cogswell.
I'm back. Okay. To clarify a point for Councilor Jordan, the temporary storage of materials is in reference to the storage of construction materials for municipal projects by the Public Works Department, and this is to contain them in this park maintenance area. And if you go down to the definitions below, it explains that instead of being able to store them in that whole general area where they have been in the past, they're now going to be using it in this more restricted area. This is with the advice, consent, and approval of the Director of Public Works, that he was very happy with this part of the definition and this language. As far as the storage of materials or equipment for the playing fields, some of these leagues already have space within the buildings in that general area already. Does that help? If we reword the temporary storage to read temporary storage of materials for municipal projects within the park maintenance area. So, I move that we preliminarily approve the policy statement as presented by the Fort Williams Park Working Group with the exceptions as listed in the definitions as put forth.
Councilor Groff.
Do Can I ask a question, and then perhaps I can second it? I don't understand, and I am, again, I am for this. I just want to make sure we do it right. I don't understand, under ordinance amendments, Fort Williams Park District, the proposed ZORC draft permitted uses, uses permitted in the Fort Williams Park District, and then two, the new addition, uses permitted in the southerly section of Fort Williams Park, A, passive recreation activities, B, one multipurpose playing field only. How is that, is the AA field considered in the southerly section of Fort Williams Park?
Yes, it is.
Yes, it is.
Well, if that's true, how can we vote to change the ZORC, approve that proposed ZORC draft, when at the beginning of this policy statement, we had a prior discussion about the current uses may continue but not be expanded, and I was assured what that meant is the AA field that is currently in place would stay in place. I don't understand that.
That's because this was expected to be fine-tuned by these other committees, and we were way behind in our deadline, as the chairman will guarantee, in getting this to be part of the overall package. If you wanted to amend that to give some consideration to, I'm not sure how to word that. This, I did consult with our planner as to how we should do this, and we didn't even talk about the AA field to be allowed to continue, but possibly be phased out.
My problem is, sitting here tonight at 11:45, I have no problem voting on the policy statement and no problem sending this and recommending. I mean, I will recommend, vote to recommend that the policy statement be approved. And I have no problem sending this. But that is one example of, I don't think anybody intended the document to have that type of internal inconsistency. And I'm just concerned that at 11:45 at night, something's going to happen here, because that isn't quite right. And I don't want the people that have worked so hard on the dedication of the southerly section of Fort Williams Park to have any surprises, and I don't want anybody else in town to have any surprises, because this compromise is too important, and people have worked too hard to have things fouled up now. It's just critically important we do this right, because this is forever. And I support that it's forever. But I want to do it in a way that we all feel comfortable and we all look back next week and next month and next year that what a great work product we did. And I want to give people confidence, and I want to restore trust, and I want the town to move forward. And this is going to happen. But let's do it right. And if you have a suggestion how to do it right tonight, I'm willing to hear it.